The hypothalamus controls the pituitary gland, and that's both the anterior and the posterior pituitary gland. And it's a region of the brain that we call neuroendocrine because it's neurons and it's hormones. We'll talk a lot more about the hormonal aspects of the pituitary gland and the hypothalamus in the endocrinology series of lectures. But what I want you to know for this neuro part is that it secretes factors, releasing factors that go from the hypothalamus through blood capillaries into the anterior pituitary and cause the release of hormones from the pituitary that go into circulation and affect the endocrine organs. So releasing factors in the hypothalamus, stimulating factors in the anterior pituitary, and then actions on the endocrine glands throughout the rest of the body. It also produces two important hormones, oxytocin and vasopressin, and they are actually made in what are called neurosecretory neurons within the hypothalamus itself. The axons of those hypothalamic neurons go through the pituitary stalk to the posterior pituitary and release their hormones into circulation within the posterior pituitary. And again, when we hit the endocrinology section of the MOOC, we'll talk a lot more about the endocrine system. As I mentioned before, the autonomics are controlled by your hypothalamus. So again, sympathetics are fight or flight, parasympathetics, rest and digest. The main control center for both of those systems is in the hypothalamus. So the hypothalamus gets information from your frontal lobe, from your thalamus, which is integrating sensory information, from your cortex, and sensory information coming up from the brainstem, and it coordinates it all to then come up with whether you should be having a parasympathetic or a sympathetic response to what's going on in your internal and external environment. And so it puts all that information together and then sends it back down to either the brainstem or the spinal cord and activates your parasympathetics or your sympathetics. It has important connections to the amygdala and the thalamus, and we'll talk about the amygdala in a separate lecture a little bit later. So what I want you to know for this, again, is that the autonomic nervous system is controlled by the hypothalamus. And then there's all these other behaviors. I mentioned that the hypothalamus is important for survival of you and of your species. So, mating behaviors, parenting behaviors, hunger, thirst, controlling your body temperature, circadian rhythms. So, the retina actually sends information directly to the hypothalamus. It has nothing to do with seeing, but it has everything to do with whether it's dark or light outside. All of these behaviors are regulated by your hypothalamus. Now, in humans, it gets a lot more complicated because we don't simply run on our hypothalamus. Otherwise, we'd be kind of like rodents. And a lot of these systems have been worked out in rodents. And so we know what, if we stimulate this part of the hypothalamus or we knock out this part, we get these real specific behaviors. Humans have, thank goodness, this big neocortex that goes over the top of our brain and pretty much can override the hypothalamus for most of the time until you get really, really hungry or really, really thirsty, and then you might kind of give in to those basic drives. But this is the kind of stuff that's running underneath the surface of a lot of your more complicated behaviors. And so your diencephalon and your hypothalamus is responsible for keeping you alive and for keeping our species alive, and all the other species that have a hypothalamus. So in summary, what do I want you to know about the diencephalon? What are its subdivisions? And name three of the functional systems that are associated with the thalamus. Name the specific sensory divisions of the thalamus and their modalities. What are the main functions of the hypothalamus? And be able to give an example of one or two of these functions. If you have a grasp on these main concepts, then you're ready for the assessment.